Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
You know, on this weekend, let's just take a moment. Thank you, Ben. Yeah, Greg, stay with me. I want to just read some things before we get into the scripture today that I think help bring us back to remember where a country like ours came from. America was really a unique country, obviously. It started with an idea. It wasn't based on a monarchy. It wasn't based on a king or just rallying around an ethnic group. It was people coming together under the idea of liberty and freedom. But yet, liberty doesn't mean what we say today, that it's just the ability to do what you want. So let's just read some of the quotes from some of our fathers, our founding fathers, and let them speak for themselves. This was in George Washington's farewell address. He said, Let us with caution indulge the supposition that morality can be maintained without religion. Whatever may be conceded to the influence of refined education on minds or peculiar structure, reason and experience both forbid us to expect that national morality can prevail in exclusion of religious principles. So this is the last thing he had to say. He said, yes, we can have great education and all of this, but without something deeper, what we're doing here isn't going to last in essence. Okay? John Adams, the second president. We have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Let me read that again. We have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Avarice, ambition, revenge, or gallantry would break the strongest cords of our Constitution as a whale goes through a net. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. Again, the uniqueness of what we have presupposes virtue, presupposes goodness. The man that's probably given the most credit of saying, well, this was the guy that was all about separation of church and state. And Jefferson, when he wrote that, it was written to a church, a Baptist church, basically saying that the government isn't going to intrude into your practices, into your liberty, not the other way around. So can the liberties, Jefferson writes, can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that those liberties are the gift of God? They that are violated but with his wrath, that they are violated but with his wrath. I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just and that his justice cannot sleep forever. Again, that sounds like, for us, some kind of angry preacher. His wrath is coming. That's Thomas Jefferson. So I think before we even get into the word today, because I'm going to talk to you, my theme is called The Law of Liberty. I just want to pray. And we need an awakening. We need a revival. We need all of those things you've heard about. Yeah, we need all of it. Awakening, revival, return to God's word. Our national nightmare of our losing our way morally, spiritually, only grows darker every day. So, Father, thank you at this time. We pause in a sober moment to acknowledge our desperate need. I thank you for those that came out on a Sunday, on a 4th of July weekend. Thank you for these precious ones that are doing whatever they know to do to put themselves in the best place to not be swept away by the winds of deception. To say, Lord, I want to know what you're saying. I want my family to be under your word. Lord, remind us of the place, as Revelation says, from which we have fallen. Lord, may we become again the people of the book, not a people of our feelings, the people marching for the rights to express our own desires in our own way. Lord, may there be something greater that we do with all of this freedom you've given us, and that your word is produced in a nation like this. Help me today to communicate clearly what your word is saying. Let me not get in the way of what your word so clearly states today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. One more thing. I'll save that. Just let me show you this picture. This is where I was on Wednesday. This is on a hillside in Pennsylvania. So all these kids out there, this is a festival, Creation Fest. The crowd probably was double that night in the concerts, but I don't think I rained on the parade there, because I was bringing the same kind of sober thing that say, you know, that we come as Christians thinking somehow that by being under this, being around a moment of religious expression and emotion, it's going to do something for us. And it isn't. We have to have something deeper. There has to be conviction. There has to be truth. We have to have something greater. And that's why today I'm talking about the law of liberty. I'll just put that last quote up that I was going to do, de Tocqueville. This was a Frenchman who came, and he, after the, of course, the French Revolution had totally opposite impact than the American Revolution. What happened in the American Revolution produced a country that was far different than the anarchy and the death and all the things that you saw in the French Revolution. And de Tocqueville came to America to search for the reasons that America had such a different outcome. In his conclusion, this was it's attributed to de Tocqueville. This was kind of a summary of what he said. Not until I went into the churches of America and heard her pulpits aflame with righteousness that I understand the secret of her genius and power. America's great because she is good. And if America ever ceases to be good, she will cease to be great. Now, I think it's important that quote precede what I'm going to say today, because goodness is not something that we can somehow just say, well, that we don't need that anymore because we have the grace of God, and that means we've got a fast pass, kind of like at Disneyland. I don't have to stand in the line. I don't have to strive and work hard. Oh, that's over, and I can sit here and just do what I want to do, and God just gives me a free pass. And that you're not going to become the person God wants you to be with that attitude. Goodness is possible. You'll find this as we look in God's word, but it doesn't come easy. Just like liberty is a free gift, but you have to fight to maintain that. So I'm going to start in James chapter 1 so you can just hear what God's word says. Verse 12, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil. He himself tempts no one, but each person is tempted when he or she is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and when sin is fully grown, it brings forth death. Now, I'm going to come back to this, but this is really kind of a progression of what happens. How can you start out so okay, and then thoughts come into your mind, giving birth to a concept, a wrong concept, and that concept then, once it's fully grown, produces a complete departure from what you thought you would start out to be. No one ever started out bad thinking that's what I'm going to be. No one's first drink was, well, this is the first drink on the way to being an alcoholic. Or I can't wait, boy, I'm going to become addicted to this. Or boy, I can't wait to depart what I know growing up, what I've grown up to live a perverse lifestyle. But then here's why he says, I wanted to come back to it, but I better start with this. Don't think when you're being down that road that you're somehow being led by God. Well, God's doing this. This must be the way I am. He said, no, you're being led astray by your own desires. And what happens is when we get led astray by our own desires, one of the biggest tricks is for that thought to come, well, this must be God because it's your desires and you need to express who you are and what you feel like. This is just the way you are. No, see, and the further you get away from the word, that's why we got to pull back. And sometimes we get so far out, it's like pulling back to get back to this word to say, wait a minute, my thinking's off. Everyone is tempted when they're led astray by their own desires. So now we've not got much distinguishing between our desires and the will of God. In fact, that's pretty much our modern Bible, is whatever we feel must be true because we felt it. This is my desire. Okay? I don't need any amens, but you can just make sure you read up on the screen. I'm serious. It goes. Everyone is tempted when they're led, and don't think you're being tempted by God. Each person is tempted, verse 14, when they're lured and enticed by their own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And when sin is fully grown, it brings forth death. So there's some little baby sins going on now, some little playing around with it now, but it's growing up to a monster. Playing around with some stuff, when sin is fully grown, it's going to bring forth death. That monster you're raising will turn and destroy you. Next verse, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. God's not shady. God's not shifty. Okay, this is not, I'm so confused. No, he's the Father of lights. He's the Father of truth. And it's ominous. It's clear. It's not so like you hear these people trying to explain how everything they're doing is really okay because God this and not that. I mean, I hear so many convoluted explanations of why people are doing crazy stuff in the name of God. Don't be deceived. God, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting or shadow due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Again, this is about not who you are, it's what God makes you to be. We are a first fruits. We are a new creation. He brought forth a new kind of creature. We're not taking ourselves and improving ourselves. The Bible says the old self has died. There's a new self. There's a new person. There's something that didn't exist before. Corinthians says, 2 Corinthians, or 2 Corinthians says, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is past and the new has come. Something new has happened on the inside of us. Okay, so everybody's trying to, well, what do you feel? What's your self? No, the old self has died. That's what he's saying. We've been brought forth, but what brought forth this new creation is the word of truth. It's the word of truth brought us forth. We'll come back to that if we have enough time. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Now, right in the middle of this text, there's a warning, especially that to realize that just getting mad about stuff isn't going to change anything. Anger, being the angry religious person, being mad at people because of the way they live, being mad at people because of what they're doing, that isn't going to change them. None of that's going to help anybody. If somebody is off in this mindset, the only power in the universe that's going to bring them back is the power of truth. Not your anger, not my anger, not me screaming, not me mocking, not me making fun of them. All of that has only given us less credibility to be able to be heard. So I spend a lot of time trying to go back and say, wait, before I can even get to the word, I've got to go back through the crazy, angry statements made by mad people who are just mad because of these people that are crazy and all these laws and bathroom issues. And look, whatever people are doing, being mad about it really isn't going to do much other than make it harder to get an audience to speak. So let me just stop. Now, I got to be careful to not be mad about those who are getting mad. See, I just put myself right in the mind saying, so you've got to kind of say, wait a minute, okay, I better calm down when I'm preaching against anger, you know. We don't need to be mad anymore. For those of you watching, this is definitely how, this is the struggle, okay. But then he right after that, the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. And then it says, therefore put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness. Say rampant wickedness. And receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. Now, our spirits are saved when we say yes to Christ. It's a miracle. But our soul, our mind, our will, and our emotions, if you will, that's the battleground, and that is being saved. Okay? In other words, You and I both know that the warfare is inside of us. This is the battleground. It's in your soul. The Apostle Peter writes and says, abstain from fleshly lust, which wage war against your soul. And so we're in an environment where our souls are being are under siege all day long. I mean, you think it's tough in Flint, Michigan to drink the water that's so polluted. Yes, it's tough. Yes, it's tragic. Yes, it's wrong. But we're living in a spiritual version of that where it's difficult to turn on any media device and not ingest inside of us the very images and thought processes that are doing to our spirits and our souls what that kind of bad polluted water is doing to people's bodies. That's what we're doing. And so I don't have time to play. I don't even have time for a cute message. I don't even have time for a nice story, a little tear or a 4th of July or something. As I get to pray, the Lord says, they don't know my word. And if they don't get the word inside of them, they will be blown away. So really, this is just a Bible study. This is helping you plug into the only thing on this planet that's going to be able to give you the power to withstand what's coming. If we're in the midst of a plague, and I'm the guy giving you the medicine that you need to be the immunity, me being up here cute and trying to draw attention to my delivery of how you take the medication and how you do this, and oh, didn't he tell us so nicely how to take that medication? No, I don't even have time for that. You better get this inside of your soul, or you won't be here. You won't be anywhere. I mean, to stand in front of that crowd of kids this week and look at them and say, according to the statistics, half of you won't even be around here once you get to college. You won't even be around here. In fact, there was a documentary crew. When I told my kids the name of the media outlet, they said, you're kidding. You met that guy? I said, yeah. But this media outlet was there chronicling, doing a documentary on this event that I was speaking at. And when they wanted to get me on, I said, hold on a minute, tell me what's the name of this documentary. No, turn the camera off. No, not yet. No, I'm not going on camera yet. I've seen Jesus Camp and Religious and all of that. Not going to play that part, you know. So let's talk a minute. Talk a minute. And by the time I began to ask questions, the guy doing the documentary was a former believer. Christian school, you know, basically it come out of all that and was really coming back into this environment to look at kind of the postmortem. Like, let me go back and see what environment used to kind of make me feel bad and manipulate me, and maybe these kids are being manipulated. And I said, look, the only difference in me and you is I know that there's an emotional moment that once a kid, if that's all they get when they get out from this, they won't last. I said, in your case, it's true. You didn't last. I said, the difference in you and me is I'm coming back in trying not to just find all the strange, you know, things and make fun of it. I'm trying to fix it. The way we fix it is not coming back and going, look, they don't know what they're doing. They're just being whipped up into a frenzy. That may be true, but that doesn't mean God doesn't exist, and it doesn't mean his word's not true. Just because this expression may be a little bit, you know, superficial, doesn't mean it's all superficial. But we got some work to do. We got some work to do. You got to put away all filthiness. Now, what I love about the word, Jesus walk into a room, people doing all kinds of stuff. Jesus just look at you and say, stop it. Stop it. Not let me get you into 7 years of counseling. Stop it. He would not tell you to do something. Put away wickedness. Put it away. Stop it. But the way you do it is by not just trying to stop it in your own strength. It says, put away all filthiness, verse 21, and rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your soul. In other words, darkness is not a thing, it's the absence of light. Just like cold is not a thing, it's the absence of heat. So when there is no word, when there is no goodness from God, this gift he's given us in his word, then the vacuum is filled. The negation of that is simply the darkness, the perverseness, all of that. But the way to overcome it is not saying, oh, well, I prayed. Oh, I said, oh, God, just take these desires away. You can do that all day long. It isn't about saying, well, I prayed and said, God, you know, I asked him to take all these desires away and they didn't go away, so this must be the way I am. No, you have to put something else inside of you and not just go by your feelings. Verse 22, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. In other words, if you don't do what this word says, you don't even need the devil. The devil goes, we don't have to mess with them anymore. I don't have to hold a gun on them. They grabbed the gun out of the devil's hand and held it on themselves. They're deceiving themselves. Let's go on to someone else. Be doers of the word and not merely hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word, not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at a mirror, his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself, goes away at once, forgets what he was like. And we'll see that. We'll see glimpses of ourselves in church or when we, I didn't look too good. Oh, that picture of me. Oh, you know, oh, that sermon made me feel bad. Oh, I don't like that. I'm not going to listen to that again. So anytime we get a bad picture of ourselves or something that we don't like, oh, we just go away and want to forget that. But that doesn't mean it goes away. It's like somebody don't want to go to the doctor because they somehow, I've actually talked to people that when I get down to it, I think, wait a minute, I think what you're saying is that if you go to the doctor, you're going to get sick. That if you don't go, that somehow you're not going to get sick, but by going to the doctor or getting an x-ray, the machine's going to give it to you. Ignoring it isn't going to make it go away. People get into these crazy thoughts in their head. Oh, well, maybe if I don't think about it, it just won't be real. Verse 24, for at once he forgets what he's like. Verse 25, for the one who looks, here comes my text. I'm taking all this time to get to the text. Who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. So you have to look intently at this law, and it almost sounds like a contradiction, the law of liberty. You see, we think that law and liberty are mutually exclusive or somehow antithetical. But because it's a law, it means we ought to see it as much as we see the law of gravity or the law of relativity or whatever law that we know is an immutable, inviolable, whatever you want to say. In other words, this is a principle. It will work. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. That's a law. And we reduce it down to some little superficial giving technique. It's far deeper than any kind of giving, offering little deal. It goes on to say, the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. The one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap life. So guess what? You're here on July 4th weekend. You are sowing to the Spirit. You got up out of the bed and came all this way down here. I'm actually preaching to somebody that's not even here. Because you came. But yet, even those of you that came that show so much effort to get down here on a weekend when you could have slept in, I don't know if I would have come if I hadn't had to preach. I'm going to just level with you. You may be a better Christian than me. Because you came here and nobody's paying you to be here. So good for you. But by coming all this way, I don't want you to be confused about what's happening around you and why people are going crazy the way they're going and why even people can be so great and religious one day and be gone tomorrow. You start getting away from this word and being led by your feelings. And next thing you know, you're so far away from anything that resembles truth. And now what's really dangerous is when you're taking your desires and kind of making that the book of whatever your name is. If you're Fred, it's the book of Fred. That's what you're reading. The book of Susan. It's your own feelings and desires codified in to say, well, this must be God because these are my beliefs. So we got to, let's just summarize it this way. You got to look intently at the law of liberty. This is the one thing that when you look intently at it, now don't tell me we don't know how to look intently, because we look intently at all kind of stuff. I mean, I know that if there's anything this culture will not be able to say is we just didn't know how to look intently. You got to look intently. You can do it. You're just looking at the wrong thing. You've got to hear constantly, and don't tell me you can't hear constantly. If I go back to my early days as a believer, and I'm still living this way, I found a way to hear constantly. Cassette tapes back in the day. And now it's even an easier way to be able to hear what you want to hear. You got to hear constantly, and you got to act immediately. Act immediately. And if you don't, then you begin to drift, and your own desires will entice you and tell you that your desires are actually God's will. I mean, I have a friend in town, a pastor friend, and he said some woman sat him down and said, you know, I'm having a love affair with my boss. No, you're not. You're in adultery. You're in adultery. Then going on to say this nonsense like, I can't, she goes into this dramatic, I can't before the Lord. He goes, stop it. Don't say that. Don't say you're not before the Lord. This isn't before the Lord. It's before your flesh and your feelings. It isn't before God's word. It's just blasphemy. Starting to sound like Stephen A. Smith. Blasphemous. This is what happens when we get further and further and further away from the truth. Go to the book of John. I don't know how much time I have, but I'm hurrying. I don't have Pastor James here to help me. I can tell when he starts fidgeting that I'm really, but I think I'm all right. John, just read this. Again, you can just not count this a sermon or a message. Count this as a Bible study. John chapter 8. Verse 31, Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. He didn't say if you raise your hand, if you come down front, if you do all this. He said, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, we are offspring of Abraham and never have been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Jesus answered them, truly I say to you, whoever practices sin. Talking about practice. 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 Truly I say to you, anyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. If you continue in my word, then you're going to be disciples. If you abide in my word. In other words, Jesus said, it isn't about, okay, you've made the little prayer. Oh, thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Oh, you came down front. Good for you. Oh, let's give him a hand clap. I'm mocking it because at times we have put into this mindset that if I walk 10 steps down to the front of a room, that's it, I made it. Now go on to the next thing. Jesus said to those who had believed in him, this was what Jesus told the people who walked down front, so to speak. If you abide in me, if you continue in my word, you are then my disciple. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The opposite is implied. If you don't continue in my word, you're not going to know the truth, and you're going to continue in greater darkness. And really, once you've come out of that, once you've come out of darkness and go back, the last state is worse than the first. Every great skeptic, and I say great in terms of their voice and their impact, every great skeptic that I can name started out religious, started out saying, I used to be like that. And then they stopped living by this word, didn't work for them. Then they began to find their passions take them away. And then they decided, I'm tired of feeling bad about this. I'm going to start feeling good about this. So they didn't want the truth. They exchanged the truth for a lie, got tired of suppressing and working against the truth, and said, my old favorite, every step away from God you take. I better be going this way. This is the wrong way on this stage. Every step away from God you take, There's somebody waiting on you to tell you you're doing the right thing. Easiest thing in the world in this world is to be deceived. I just didn't know. Let me close with 2 Peter. 2 Peter. Second Peter chapter 1. If there's anybody that could give us some advice about backsliding, it's Peter. My man here is talking from experience. Verse 3, he says, His divine power has granted to us all things pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us to His own glory and excellence, by His own glory and excellence, by which He has granted to us His precious and very great promises, so that through them you might become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of evil desire. Now, let me unravel that a minute. I remember when I was a young man, I did everything I could to gain weight. I would get a blender, put protein powder, always had to put an egg. Everybody just said, you got to put an egg in it. So crack that egg. If you'd have told me, get you some nails, get you some dirt, and put that in there with that egg, then okay, I would have done anything to gain power. Okay, we've got little five-hour energy drinks, people getting busted because of performance-enhancing drugs. What are they doing? They're trying to take something in that makes their performance better. Well, that's exactly what Peter is saying, that we've been given these precious promises, and in those promises are the divine nature. And when you partake of that divine nature, you're going to take something in that's going to give you power to escape all that's around you, which means we have to do something. Our effort or our lack thereof will have a determination on our spiritual outcome. And that doesn't do well in a nice southern fried grace. Well, I don't want to hear that. I just want to sit here and let somebody tell me how good I am and God loves me just the way I am. And I just want to sit right here, flip by. I'm going to get me another preacher that's not going to make me feel so bad. I hope I make you a nervous wreck. Because when we stand before God on Judgment Day, you're not going to be over there and go, well, you know, He told me if I just put my hand on the screen or give Him a little love offering or buy His book, that He was going to speak for me. He was going to, there, you can't buy your way into this. You can't give enough money to get you the cut in line so that I don't have to do all that. I'm a giver. I gave a big check to the building fund. He says, you partake of the divine nature through the promises. I remember Pastor Steve Merle and I, the other day, one of our original college roommates came to town. We hadn't seen him in years. I remember when he came into our student fellowship at Mississippi State, he said, I love to cook. I'm going to cook for y'all. I love to cook. Can I cook? I said, okay. All of us are terrible, you know, whatever you want to do. So when I finally went into the full-time ministry, I remember he cooked me my first meal as a full-time pastor. And the meal, the entree was chicken necks. And I remember he put that bowl of chicken necks in front of me. And I said, Dad, did you eat the meat? But he taught me that there was more there than met the eye. And see, sometimes you pick up the Bible, there's nothing here. Listen, honey, you're going to have to work that word like you're going to work a rib bone tomorrow. You're going to be working that word. And next thing you know, what you thought was nothing there, all of a sudden, there's a breakthrough. But that's how I am with the word. I work the word. I work it. I say, you know, it doesn't feel like anything. It just looks like a little Bible verse. But, you know, the more you look intently into it, the more you meditate on it. Here's how you know you meditate on the word long enough. When it becomes your meditation. You think and look into the word until it becomes what you're worried about. It becomes what you're thinking about. Because what we do is we read our Bible and say, I've done it, and then we rush back and think about what we want to think about. But when you've looked intently, you and meditate constantly, then now the word of God is on your mind all the time. I'm thinking about it. In other words, it's so implanted inside of me that my soul now has power to say no. My soul has power to withstand the pressure around me. My soul isn't just giving in to every little thing that comes around and, oh, well, I just felt, oh, well, today I'm saved, but tomorrow I'm not sure. Now there's something inside of you. Now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond all we can ask or think, according to the power that's at work on the inside of you. So what's at work on the inside of you? Paul says we preach the word, which does its work in you. The word has the energy. It's the very thing that brought the planet into existence. If God can sustain the universe by the power of his word, he can sustain you and me by the power of his word. But we got to get close to it. We've got to partake of it. It says, now watch this. He says, for this very reason, verse 5, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue. There it is. It's goodness. Virtue is simply goodness. So you can't have faith without virtue. Supplement your faith with virtue. And virtue with knowledge. And knowledge with self-control. In other words, your faith ought to be producing a changed behavior that not only, and then you don't change a little bit, you grow in knowledge, you grow in virtue. Now you're growing in self-control. Now all of a sudden, you're not just blown by every feeling and desire and impulse. You're now growing and that you're now able to control yourself. Not have it like be a wild horse, take you wherever you want to, wherever it wants to go. And self-control, steadfastness. In other words, it's not just a weekend thing or a once a month thing or a summer camp thing. And steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, in other words, you should look back and say, it isn't, well, I really was saved and fired up back then, but now, you know, I've learned to kind of chill. I'm kind of chilling in the wheel now. I mean, I'm kind of grown up and kind of mature. No, you, these qualities of virtue and knowledge and self-control ought to be greater than they were when you got started. If they're yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. For whoever lacks these qualities, verse 9, is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election, for if you practice, I'm talking about practice, these things, you will never fail. Stand to your feet. You will never fail. I'm going to tell you, if there's anything that this church is dedicated to, is just to getting you, just to bump you into this Bible. When I was a lifeguard, when I was younger, if somebody was struggling, you just wanted to kind of just push them towards something, the shore. I spend my days just bumping people, get them close to, and say, look, don't wait until your life is so falling apart. Then you get into some program that where you have no other choice. And you know what they're going to do? They're going to start telling you your habits, what you look at, what you listen to. In other words, you're going to live in a, if you're in a desperate place, they'll give you the measures I'm talking about now. But don't wait till it gets to be there's nothing else. Till you're just almost on the edge of the abyss. Live that way now. You can do it. If you don't, that doesn't mean you won't go to heaven. You'll just get there faster. You follow me? The easiest thing on this planet to do is just to let go and just drift. But living, keeping the word inside of you, guarding your heart with all diligence. Why? Out of your heart flow the forces of the issues of life. Bruce and Carol, I met you in 1981 on your campus. Carol came up to me. She was going to marry another guy, University of Washington. Aren't you glad she came to hear me preach? You're glad. You've known me since 1981 when I came to your campus. I'm preaching the same thing. Just the same thing. Just fixed it up a little bit and changed it a little bit here. You know, had to get a bigger waist. Guy asked me, how old are you? I said, I'm in my 40s. He said, what? I said, oh, I thought you were talking about my waist. No, I'm not that big. I have a 32, but a 36 feel good. So good, I buy a 38. But anyway, that's just all. I had to have a little comic relief in here. It's been heavy today. But I'm just saying that this is, but by the grace of God, we're here. But you know what? It's not over. Race isn't over. We stop living this way. As Paul said, if I stop living this way, even though I preach to you, I myself become a castaway. And if anything happens to me bad, God forbid, and I become a phony or a castaway, don't put your trust in me. Put it in this word. Put it in this word. Say, you know what? You know what? He should have done what he told us to do. The guy that led me to the Lord backslid. The guy that led me to the Lord backslid. I went and found the guy that led me to the Lord and re-led him to the Lord. So when we tell our story, he goes, he led me to the Lord. Well, he led me to the Lord. I mean, it's confusing. But you can become the one in need if you stop living this way. So what's my call today? Is it just if you feel bad or you hadn't done right lately, come down front? No, it's are we willing to become these kinds of people in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation? That's what the Bible calls it. It says if you live this way, you'll shine like lights in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation. And we're not mad at them for being wicked and perverse. That's just what happens when you are separated from God. If you're apart from the word, like the gut commercial says, that's just what you do. But if you're a believer, Jesus said, if you're my disciples, you stay in my word, you live in there. I remember when I was reading books to my little kids and they liked the book, they'd try to put their foot in the book. When they were little babies, they'd try to get in the book. I'm still trying to get in the book. I'm trying to find my way into the book, into that promise. I'm like an old bird dog scratching in the yard, just scratching, trying to find. You know, leave a dog in the backyard. I'm digging up every verse. I'm scratching around in the. I'm just trying to find. I'm trying to get into this word. God, don't let me. Don't leave me to my flesh. Don't leave me to my desires. God, please rescue me, Lord. And I know your word. I know it created the universe. God, I just need you so bad. Let me. You said, if I seek you, I'll find you. Let me pray. Lord, thank you. As our ministry team comes down front, thank you. Thank you, God, for this people that they're here. Thank you that I have somebody to talk to today, to tell this to, that I'm not just talking to myself, walking around wondering who I could tell this to. Thank you for the privilege of being able to communicate clearly or the best I can, that there's a way, and you're the way. You're the truth. You're the life. Lord, may we become people that are disengaging from those things which are unfruitful. We've looked intently at the wrong thing. We've heard frequently the wrong thing, and we've acted on the wrong thing. Lord, may we look intently into this law of liberty. May we hear it frequently. May we become people that, if faith comes by hearing, Lord, then let us hear it all the time. God, make us the kind of people that act, not deceiving ourselves, but act upon it, regardless of what we feel like. Whoever you are, your needs, maybe you just, if you came here on Sunday morning, probably not, you're not really running from God that hard if you came here. So thank God you're here. But whatever it is, just we're here to pray with you. Lord, thank you for seeing hearts and minds today. You are the one that knows all. Energize men and women today, boys and girls. Wake us up. Give us an awakening, not just in the country, but here. And Lord, may this produce the fruit of righteousness. We're not going out to be angry at people or getting mad at them. Lord, we've been so patient with us. May we so be filled with your love and your word that people are drawn irresistibly to the joy and the confidence that we have. Make us these lights that you promised we would be. A city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. In this time and for our country, Lord, if believers around this country would just be who they are, this country would dramatically turn. No forces of darkness are going to be the cause of our demise. It will be us capitulating and surrendering. May need, as soon as I say amen, if you just think, you know, my life's not right, we've got people all down front to help you. Thank you, Jesus. Help us, God. Help us by letting us know that it's more than just saying help us. It's by acting on what you've told us to do. Now that we've heard, now may we respond immediately today. Today. Amen. Pastor Jim, a unique voice, Pastor Jim LaFoon, will be here on Wednesday night. So you don't want to miss that. He's an incredible teacher and has a very unique gift called prophetic, which means he really has some amazing insight, so you don't want to miss that. We love you very much. Whatever your needs are, we're here to pray. God bless you as you go. Don't eat too much tomorrow. Stay safe.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life.
Bethel World Outreach Church, reaching a city to touch the world.